Namibia. For time immemorial, dry ocean winds have been sucking moisture out of this desert landscape. Every day, the winds sculpt the sand dunes anew, from the coast far into the country's interior. It is a forbidding, almost alien environment. Only creatures with specially developed skills are able to survive here. Even humans have managed to eke out an existence in Namibia's harsh desert, like the Himba people, for example. Namibia is located on the western coast of Africa. The Kunene forms its northern border with Angola, and the Oranje its southern border with South Africa. At the end of the 19th century, the country was separated from Botswana to the east by an arbitrary line drawn by the colonial powers of the time. Sand and gravel dominate large areas of the country. The Namib, the oldest desert in the world, stretches 2,000 kilometers from north to south and reaches up to 500 kilometers inland. In the local language, Namib fittingly means vast, raw surface. The true scope of its size and many faces can only really be fathomed from the air. It stretches out like an ocean made of sand, seemingly uninhabited and lifeless. Dry air is due to the cold ocean currents flowing just off the coast. The first rays of the morning sun quickly banish the icy cold of the night air. Temperature is still barely above freezing. Within 2 hours, the sand will be blazing hot. It is a land of extremes, in which only life forms with very special skills have any hope of survival at all. Because of the stable air currents, it almost never rains in the Namib. The dwarf puff adder covers its moisture needs with drops of dew that collect on its rough skin. Even its method of locomotion is best suited to the desert conditions. Its sidewinding action provides for the least possible contact with the hot desert sand and still allows for fast forward movement. Thanks to this technique, the puff adder is among the fastest snakes in the world. During the heat of the day, it buries itself in the sand with only its eyes, nose, and the tip of its tail exposed. Thank you. Its eyes are located at the top of its head. That is a peculiarity in the snake kingdom. Camouflage doesn't work any better than this. The diversity of Namibia is also reflected in the variety of its inhabitants. Of the 7 indigenous gecko species in Namibia, only the Namib sand lizard, also known as the palmetto lizard, is nocturnal. During the early morning hours, he looks for an appropriate place to spend the day. Its skin looks as thin as parchment, and the conspicuous coloration is rather unusual for a nocturnal creature. Is it to trick its enemies into believing that it is poisonous? Only its split pupil hints at its way of life. At daybreak, the lizard digs a hole in the sand up to 80 centimeters deep. That is enough to provide protection from the heat of the day. The palmetto lizard's toes are connected with a membrane of skin similar to the fins of water creatures. That not only makes digging easier, but also provides a greater footprint for ease of movement over the soft sand of the desert. As some draw back to rest, others are just beginning their day's work. The black beetle is a typical desert dweller. The heat doesn't bother him at all. Long legs suspend the beetle's body high above the desert floor. It literally hovers above the hot sand, and he runs as fast as he can. That provides a bit of cooling. Black beetles feed primarily on plant particles. Normally, the desert provides precious little along those lines, but the beetle has an ally. Nearly without let-up, strong winds blow over the Namib carrying minuscule plant particles from thousands of kilometers away. Relatives of the black beetle can be found at our latitude as well, such as the flower beetle, whose larva, the mealworm, is raised as feed for small terrarium animals. This desert dweller isn't taking a dive to get out of the sun, but to hide from its natural enemies. Of course, most animals are to be found where the desert has more to offer than just sand. This small oasis around the dollar bush is the chameleon stomping grounds. It is still a bit stiff from the cold of the night. It can often take up to an hour before it is warmed up to normal operating temperature. The namakwa, or desert chameleon, is active during the day. It requires a certain temperature to really get going. Why did life forms such as this reptile ever find their way into the desert? The best place to find answers to that question is in Dead Fly, the Valley of Death. Dead Vlei lies at the end of a former river which deposited so much clay sediment that it had to find somewhere else to flow. Lack of water caused the trees to die off, one after the other. Most of these have been dead for over 500 years. The rotting process progresses extremely slowly under these dry conditions. Receded nearly imperceptibly over a period of probably thousands of years. Indigenous creatures had sufficient time to either adapt to the changing environment or to migrate to more hospitable habitats. Some learn to survive in the new environment, a world dominated by dryness, heat, and wind. To this day, there are rivers that penetrate deep into the Namib, at least from time to time. 400 kilometers inland. At this point, the desert rises to become a hilly plateau of barren rock. The country's few wellsprings bubble up from among the rocky debris. Every couple of years, torrential rains actually fill up the dry riverbeds with water. They become life-giving streams that penetrate deep into the Namib Desert. The debris collected at the foot of the trees testifies to the water level of the last flash flood. But most of the time, the spring waters run deep underground, out of sight and unreachable for man and beast. And yet it is said that life exists in these valleys. Only few have seen them with their own eyes, the desert elephants. Finding these gray Namib giants means pressing into remote areas of the country. It is an expedition requiring a lot of time and great patience. With a bit of luck, we may run across herdsmen belonging to the Himba people on our journey through the solitary Kawakafeld. This tribe was the first to arrive in the Huarosib Valley. The Himba are half nomads. They move with their herds of cattle and goats on their seasonal migrations from one source of water to the other. They measure their wealth in the number of animals they possess. Their most important food source is curdled cow milk, often the only liquid available to the Himba. How long they are able to stay in one place is determined primarily by the grazing land. Once the herds find nothing else to eat, the Himba must move on. They often return to their villages after a time. This settlement is very primitive, however, and furnished with only the very barest of necessities. But Kamahuu and his family are satisfied. The last place they stayed had several finished clay huts, but that area is suffering a drought at the moment. 30-year-old Kamahuu is just about to take a second wife. The Himba are polygamous by tradition. Each man may have several wives. Men of marrying age wear a braid. The young men spend nearly their entire day in trying to make a good impression on the young ladies. To an outsider, the distribution of labor between the sexes seems unfair. There are hardly any day-to-day tasks that the women are not responsible for, from building the huts to collecting the wood and tending the goats to raising the children. The men's only task is to take care of the cattle, but now that they have found a good grazing ground, they save themselves that work as well. Kamahuu is quite content. The village where his future bride lives is very close by. But he is not allowed to show up there personally. Umbratena, his future wife, is no ordinary bride. The girl is only 13 years old and just coming of age to marry. The girl wears an ivory-covered belt around her waist to let all the men know that she is taboo. The virginity belt is recognizable from afar and sends a clear signal to all men, hands off. Today, the future bride works to produce the powder used to make the coveted red skin paint, a tedious task. At her wedding, Umbratena will be allowed to participate in the dance of the adults for the first time. At the dress rehearsal, the girl demonstrates her skill for her mother, Maria, and Kaobo, her bridesmaid. Kaobo shows her the steps again. Then it is Umbratena's turn. The dancer stomps her feet like a cow and moves her arms in the air to symbolize its horns. The rhythm is in her blood, and she has the dance down to perfection. Nothing more stands in the way of the wedding. In the meantime, word has gotten around about where the elephants are. To get there, we make our way through a narrow ravine that is hardly visible from a distance. Our goal is just behind it. The neighboring dry river valley of the Namib. Surface water flows in the Namib for only a few days a year, but underground there is always sufficient moisture to sustain some vegetation. Footprints the size of medicine balls confirm that the desert elephants have passed by. But our elephant tracker, Dieter Risser, tells us that the prints are already a couple of days old. But there is a good chance that they will return soon. Our film team moves to higher ground to get a better overview of the landscape. And they get incredibly excited by what they see. A herd of elephants heading right toward them. An estimated 600 desert elephants live in the Kaoko Veld. They have adapted to life in this barren environment in a unique way. They often need to travel as far as 70 kilometers between their feeding grounds and their watering holes, depending on how many calves are in the herd. Journeys of that length make heavy demands on the animal's energy reserves. There is no water in the Namib at the moment, but at least there is plenty of green vegetation to fill the bellies of these majestic creatures. Even the youngest gets its needs met. These desert dwellers are not picky. They eat leaves and tender shoots, as well as bark, flowers, and fruit. They even eat roots, onions, and other tubers. A grown elephant consumes up to 100 kilograms of plant matter every day. The youngest of the herd takes advantage of the break to rest and recuperate from the long trek. But the older animals never spend much time on one type of plant. Each type of vegetation contains different important nutritional elements, and the gray giants instinctively go after a healthy mixed diet. The lead animal of a desert elephant herd is always a cow. She leads the way, and the rest of the family follows, her sisters, aunts, and cousins, along with their offspring. The bull follows last of all. He provides the rear guard and makes sure no one is left behind. The fantastic memory of the desert elephant is the secret to their survival. They remember the locations of hidden water sources and feeding grounds, even if they haven't been there for years. They pass their knowledge on from one generation to the next. The trails of the desert elephants are often hundreds of years old. The most recent DNA analysis leads scientists to believe that the desert elephant is a unique species apart from the jungle and savanna elephants. They also differ from other pachyderms in appearance. Relative to their body size, they have larger ears and broader feet. Thanks to their larger footprint, the animals are able to maintain a better footing on the soft sand of the desert. In addition, the sensitive soles of their broad feet pick up vibrations from the surface below. The lead cow places her feet on the ground like a stethoscope. Then she listens to determine if perhaps water lies hidden somewhere underground. Thanks to their uncanny ability to locate water, desert elephants often determine the survival of other animals as well. The herd does not relax until the lead cow has found and uncovered the coveted water source. It is just a question of how long the animals can endure the search. Back at the Himba village, wedding preparations are in full swing. On the day before the big celebration, the men have only one task. In honor of the bride, they must slaughter a cow. In order to appease the spirit of the sacrificial cow, they practice a ritual passed down over hundreds and hundreds of years. In the Himba tribes, the healer and the medium that makes contact with the ancestral spirit world is most often the oldest woman of the village. As soon as she falls into a trance, she slips into the spirit of the cow. Then the men symbolically kill her with a knife. Finally, the cow dies and offers its soul for the future of the newlyweds. After that, in the reality of the physical world, things progress very rapidly. In contrast to what the ceremony suggests, when the Himba slaughter an animal, it is never bloody. The desert dwellers cannot afford to waste a single drop of the precious liquid life's blood. The animal is strangled with a few quick and efficient strokes. The women also still have a lot of preparation work to do. Tradition demands that a new hut be built for the bridal couple. The outer surface of a Himba hut is made primarily from cow dung. According to tribal law, men are not allowed to touch dung or offal of any kind. That leaves the task of building all the huts to the women. Just like mixing cement, the cow dung is mixed with sand and water. Because water is such a precious commodity in the desert, the Himba always save this task until the springs in the area are flowing naturally. Only out of the abundance of nature would the Himba dare to lavish such a valuable resource on a construction project. Even the date of the wedding ceremony itself is determined by the availability of an abundant flow of water. The foundation of the hut is made up of simple branches and twigs, even though it has to carry an enormous weight. The roof of cow dung alone weighs 2 tons. Supporting the weight of a person is no problem at all for this construction. It takes the women about 2 weeks to complete a hut from start to finish. The Himba dream house is made from the ingredients that nature provides as an afterthought: dried, broken off bits of trees and bushes, cow dung, a bit of water, and lots of sand. In the western part of Namibia, the ocean stops the desert. The cold, nutrient-rich Benguela current flows along this barren coast. The same scene replays itself every morning. Condensed ocean water forms a broad bank of fog at the edge of the Namib. Sometimes the fog banks penetrate deep into the desert. The black beetle would certainly perish if it missed its regular appointment with the life-giving fog. Its time has now come. As soon as the beetle has reached the highest point of the dune, he turns into the wind and freezes in position. He waits until dewdrops form on his shell. This unique moisture harvesting strategy gives the beetle an advantage over all other desert dwellers. The beetle is able to survive for weeks on its moisture reserves, even under conditions of extreme heat. Freshly tanked up, the beetle has become a virtual water bomb, and the gecko lizard knows it. The fog has lured the nocturnal reptile out of its lair. As with all other predators in the Namib, the gecko acquires the liquid it needs to survive only via its prey. He sets his sights on his victim and runs right into a trap. The predator becomes the prey. The fog penetrates deeper into the Namib. Here on the coast, it has already dissipated. As the chameleon finishes his warm-up exercises, a black beetle catches his eye. After taking plenty of time to think it over, he takes up the chase, chameleon style. There is no way the reptile can keep up with the speed of the beetle. So he has to depend on the weakness of his intended prey. The beetle seems to dash randomly back and forth across the dune. If it isn't careful, it will run right into the chameleon's mouth. But before that can happen, another chameleon appears on the scene. Now it could get dangerous. Nearly all chameleons are strictly loners and do not tolerate others of their kind who dare to get too close. In order to intimidate the intruder, the dark-colored animal makes himself as large as possible and presents his broadside. And then he waits to see what will happen. And sure enough, the intruder literally tucks its tail between its legs and moves on. Now our chameleon could get back to the business of the beetle. This tasty morsel is not only a good source of protein, but also precious liquid. After his meal, the chameleon meanders sedately back into the sparse vegetation of the desert. There might be another snack waiting for it when it finally gets there. That was a good start to the day. In the meantime, the wind has driven the moist ocean air 300 kilometers inland, all the way to the Namib. There is no sign of the elephants. Have they hidden in the fog? Yet even at midday, when the fog is dissipated, the elephant family does not come to light. Dieter Risser assumes that the herd has moved on to the Huarosib, a parallel valley to the north. That would be the only place where water might possibly be found at this time of year, but it is about a day's march away. Our film team and the elephant experts take up the chase. Giraffes are normally found only on the wooded savanna or African plains, but they too have been able to adapt to this harsh habitat. They also have very likely developed into a unique subspecies, much like the elephants did. The martial eagle, Africa's largest, is a true desert specialist. The shy animal avoids wooded areas. It can spot its prey from as far as 2 kilometers away. The view into the Huarosib Valley exceeds all expectations. And there really is water here. After several days touring the desert, refreshment for the eyes as well as the soul. our elephant family doesn't seem to have arrived yet, but a lone bull is busy quenching his thirst. Seeing that he is satisfied after only a few swallows, it is obvious that he has been here for a while already. But after a couple of days at the latest, he will also move on. There is not much to feed on here. Many of the plants available in the Namib do not grow here, and vice versa. That is the only thing that forces the pachyderms to continuously stay on the move. Hardly any wild animals have their permanent home here in the river valley. Even the Nama flying hens are only visiting. They are able to store water in their breast feathers and transport it over long distances to their nesting places where they pass the life-giving liquid on to their young. The bull elephant has discovered an apple ring acacia tree with ripe fruit. The pods are hanging high up, too high even for the elephant. But the animal knows just what to do. Even fruit that would otherwise be out of his reach stand no chance against this technique. Acacia trees are common in the dry riverbeds of the northern Namib. Wild animals feed on their nutritional pods as happily as the cattle of the Himba do. Himba village buzzes with excitement. Today is wedding day. Using water sparingly is the key to survival in the desert. Regular bathing in water is not a common practice. But the creative Himba have come up with other ways to maintain personal hygiene. Himba women actually use smoke as a means of cleansing and disinfection. They add disinfecting herbs to the wood coals, not only for their cleansing properties, but also for their pleasant scent. For genital hygiene, the women sit on a specially constructed basket placed over the coals. The mother of the bride is tired. All of the many preparations for the wedding have taken their toll. Today, much more effort than usual is invested in skin care and makeup to get ready for the big event. The red hematite powder is mixed with fat and carefully applied. Umbratena is not yet allowed to wear this coloring. Then the women don their special head coverings. Kaobo, her bridesmaid, and the second maid of honor wear their ekoris. These are leather head coverings which every woman receives at her wedding. Only Umbratena doesn't have one yet. She dons a wig instead. The fringes hide her face so that she does not allow herself to be blinded by optical impressions. Starting today, she will wear this head covering for 5 days. The beef is already steaming in the cooking pots. The celebration can begin. The Himba wedding ceremony is a clearly defined ritual. Umbratena leaves her mother's hut under the protection of the bridegroom and the bridesmaids. Crawling forward on her knees, she demonstrates her humility and gratitude to the village in which she was born and which contributed to her upbringing. She will never call this hut home again. In solemn procession, the wedding party proceeds to the new hut. Guadubiru, Ubratena's younger sister, observes the proceedings carefully. One day, she will also marry according to this ritual. To the delight of all, the meat is distributed in generous portions. They don't get to enjoy beef every day. Only the bridal couple and closest family members remain in the bridal hut, but even they quickly join the feast. The ritual dances begin in the subdued light of the full moon. The first to enter the circle are Kamahuu's best men. Then Ubertena's bridesmaids join in. Finally, the bride herself makes her grand debut. She performs the dance she has rehearsed with confident grace. The wedding festivities will continue far into the night. It is time for our camera crew to say goodbye to the Himba, this amazing people that understands like no one else what it means to survive in the desert and to stay true to their ancient culture over the centuries. The following morning already, the team arrives in the Hoanib Dry River Valley and witnesses an unusual spectacle. Dieter Risser finds fresh tracks of our elephant family. The camera team takes up position at the observation point, and their efforts are well rewarded. The elephants are really here. Even the bull elephant from the neighboring valley shows up. Thank you. It is amazing how quickly they covered the great distance involved. The bull gets wind of the camera team. But they manage to get out of harm's way just in time. The bull's aggressive reaction to our team's presence indicates that he is rutting. He presents himself to the elephant family from a respectable distance. He wants to approach one of the cows. The male head of the family, however, would never let that happen. He immediately takes up a defensive position against the intruder. At first, the antagonists simply take stock of each other. The intruder wants to know if he has a chance. The first physical exchange was not conclusive. The bulls face off again. Neither gives an inch. Now it gets dangerous. Is decided. The challenger gives up and the family bull chases him away. Journey through the surreal, inhospitable, and yet beautiful desert in southwestern Africa. Man as well as beast have found ways to deal successfully with the harsh realities of this extreme environment. They prove with each new day that the seemingly impossible is possible. Life in one of the driest places in the world, the Namib, the desert paradise of Namibia.